Hello everyone, and thanks for letting me stand here and talk to you about the topic that has been my number one topic myself, the overload of all of us, of knowledge workers. So I'm going to talk about the probably number one challenge of all people who deal with information, which is probably everyone here in that room. But I'm not just want to talk about the problem, that's just a small piece. I would like to talk about how we can fix it. So it's about the number one challenge of knowledge worker, which we call at Evernote the triple overload. Why is it not double and quadruple? You will see that in a moment, but this is how we call it. And the focus will really be on how to overcome it, what to do. And instead of just talking about theory, at the end I'm going to show you how we at Evernote address this issue ourselves in our company. Right? So first I'm going to quickly talk about certain things have changed, and I kindly invite you to think about, when you look at all those things, did you know all that? And have you changed as much as the world has changed? Like you as a person, but also you as a company. Okay? So let's start with a company that we all know, Nokia. We all know that was number one and then had some problems, right? Was the number one 10 years ago still. And then Nokia had a problem, but Samsung, who was not famous for cell phones, I still know Samsung from 99 euro music chain station and this kind of things. It's not really a powerful brand for telecommunications. Samsung is now number one for cell phones in terms of number of cell phones. Apple, who almost went bankrupt, is now number one, not in terms of how many cell phones they sell, but how much money they make. So the former number one is gone, and two companies who had nothing to do with cell phones are now number one, right? So here, this is about 10 years ago at Forbes, where they said Nokia, 1 billion, not million, 1 billion Nokia phones were in the market with an activated SIM card. Just think about the logistics of selling 1 billion hardware pieces. It's huge, right? They even wrote, can anyone catch the cell phone king? A month later, Android and the iPhone came. And then interesting things happened. The global number one, where everyone thought Nokia's going to be here in 100 years. The strongest in innovation, biggest marketing budgets, cool hardware, high quality hardware, right? They announced they're not going to use their own OS, operating system anymore. And then the board of directors said, you know what? We don't even believe in our company. We missed an important trend. So let's try to sell the company as long as it's still worth something, right? So they found someone who bought it for $5.4 billion. Microsoft. They then invested themselves about $3 billion. But soon later, they didn't know what to do with it themselves, and they made a gift to Foxconn for 350 tiny little millions. From more than 5 billion to 350 millions, they said, please take it, right? Probably they could have waited a month more and they would have given it for free. And Nokia was gone. The number one that Forbes wrote, like, who can catch the cell phone king? Gone. So this is my favorite slide. Just goes back to you. So what does that mean? If you go home now, what would you take home and tell your friend, girlfriend, husband, mother? Usually people in the first two rows are kindly invited a bit more than those back end. Yeah. For good answers, I have a little gift, by the way. Maybe that helps. Yeah, here, yeah. Okay, never be on the first page in Forbes with a good message, because then you should sell your stocks. Good one, so you will get afterwards a gift. Anyone else who wants an Evernote gift? Any other lesson that you could learn from that? Yeah? Yeah, maybe it's always someone who does it one day better than you, even if you are number one, yeah? Never take things for granted, yeah? So the three of you can come afterwards to me, right? Yeah. 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 There is a proverb. I have to say it in German because it only works in German. Is Wenn du nicht mit der Zeit gehst, gehst du mit der Zeit. I cannot translate it in English because it doesn't make any sense. But what it means if you don't do what it is actually what you said. You have to adapt. If not, you are gone one day. So I had also some learnings here. One is, if you're number one, maybe 50 years ago, you could say, oh, I'm number one. So for the next 10 years, I'm fine, right? Because time of change was slow. Nowadays, you are number one. In 2 years, you are bankrupt. So being number one doesn't give you any time advantage anymore. Another thing is, if you miss an important megatrend, we'll have a look at a couple of them afterwards. If you miss an important megatrend, you're out even faster than you can think. Nokia missed the megatrend. BlackBerry missed the megatrend. Kodak, we all know. Evergreen example. There are many others. So if you read this, would you have known that? I was once invited to give a speech for a Swiss baby online shop company. I Googled a bit and found this. So I went to this company, to the board of directors, gave that speech, and the room was quiet. It is their industry that they sell baby stuff online, baby products. They didn't know that 40% of the revenue comes from people who don't have babies. And even worse, 60% of the profit comes from those 40%. What happened? Any ideas? Grandparents, gifts. We live in the age of giving a gift. When I was a little boy, I got gifts twice a year. Birthday and Christmas, right? Nowadays, my little son is 5-year-old. Whenever we have a visitor, even if I sent them an email the day before, please, big phone, don't bring anything. We have no space. They always come with a gift. Right? It's like a human right now. So, this is one thing, a mega trend. People just bring gifts. Even if you tell them in writing, no, they still do it. The other thing is, if you're a grandmother, right, do you give them the little cheap thing for €2.99? Or do you buy the nice whatever with Spider-Man logo, which is €19.99, with a huge margin? For your little honey bunny, you want the best, right? It's just the way that we are human beings, right? So that's why those 40% generate 60% of the money, because a grandmother doesn't really, they would just want the best. So this is a mega trend you need to understand. You should have seen the eyes and especially the open mouth, those people. It's their industry. They didn't know it. How much time did I use to find out that? What do you think?
3 seconds.
I'm not so productive. 2 minutes, yeah. Two and a half minutes. So I told them, guys, don't tell me that you don't have once a year, 2.5 minutes, to Google your own industry to find out about megatrends. Nobody can be so busy, right? Don't fool yourself. They missed the megatrend. And it doesn't require money to find out about megatrends. You just need to take out some time, get out of the hamster wheel that you are in every day running faster, and Google a bit or talk to people. Here is another nice slide. When the smartphone boom started, digital cameras, gone. MP3 player, gone. Portable navigation system, who needs them? You have Google Maps, you can have offline version, camcorders. The market all is almost gone. Not over 100 years, a couple of years. Here, also leadership has changed. In the past, they told you in the morning, you have to do this. And then you come back and ask me again what you have to do. Right? Now we have a new way of how you should manage people. The good people don't stay if you are the boss style. Good people stay, and you can attract good people if you are the leadership style manager. It's a megatrend. You need to know that. If you don't know that, you don't get good people, or you get them and don't keep them. This is top US companies over the last 100 years. Give you some time to study that. Huge difference. Do you still see oil companies on the right-hand side? Tiny Little, yeah. GM went bankrupt, Enron went bankrupt, and so on. The list is long. If you don't really do those efforts, the 2.5 minutes at least once a year to understand what the hell is actually going on, high level, you just miss the boat. You can go bankrupt in a very productive way. Right? You can do the wrong thing in an incredibly productive way. Like, if you are very productive, you are bankrupt even earlier, right? So it's not just about being productive. You have to do the right thing, right? If you do the wrong thing, don't do it in a productive way, so you have a little bit more time. Unfortunately, this one I couldn't find in English, but here you can see the platform differences. By the way, you see that Europe is nowhere. And the main reason for that are our labor laws. That many countries don't allow people to think and be creative anymore. So we should think here in Europe, not just about GDPR, that's okay, but we should think about some other stuff only, also. Because if that continues that way, our kids will not have jobs here. Because the money is in the big bubbles. And there are some old companies that have been here for more than 100 years. At the moment, they are famous for cheating with diesel engines and all that stuff. That's probably not the future. If you cheat, one day they will figure it out. Because the mega trend is transparency. Right? Don't even think about cheating. One day they will find it out. So what? My next favorite slide. Anything you would take home now from that? Sorry? Use Google more often, yeah. I'm not from Google, I've worked 6 years at Google now and whatever, not, but use what is around, like. I call this DNS, do not schedule. Once a week, I have a 2-hour block in my calendar, do not schedule. If then I really have a client meeting, then I move it to another day, but I never delete it. If I cannot think and read and think and talk to other people once a week, I'm going to be the next Kodak and the next Nokia, also as a person. Because we all have to think about employability. Will someone employ you in 10 years from now? If you do repetitive things, then not, because then we have robots and software. So we need to focus on things that the robot cannot do. What are those skills? And if you want to have those skills in 10 years, you should start thinking and learning that now. Not when you lose the job and say, oh my God, right? Unemployed, what should I do now? 3 kids and 2 mortgages and unemployed? Not fun. So think earlier. So in a nutshell, don't miss a megatrend. That's my major thing here. Don't miss a megatrend. And don't just run in the hamster wheel every day and another day and another day. This is what those big companies did before they failed. It has always worked like this the last 10 years. You have maybe heard that also, right? Yeah. Nokia said the same thing. So now I want to talk about the triple overload and not the triple hamburger overload. But this picture came up when I Googled triple. I want to see what actually comes up at Google and I Googled triple. Triple hamburger, okay. I'm not going to talk about hamburger and calories and that stuff. I'm going to talk about the triple overload. Here are 4 numbers. Would like to talk to you. The first one is 2.5 hours. Our research has shown that 2.5 hours, this is the time an average knowledge worker searches for information per day. Not at once, spread over the whole day. On your cell phone, tablet, computer, searching something in your drawer, whatever. 2 to 2.5 hours a day. That's a lot of time. That is about 30% of your salary cost, by the way. The higher your salary is, the bigger is that waste of money. So as a company, companies who know that say, wait a moment, we have to work on that. Because the second number makes the whole thing worse. IDC says in 14 months from now, all data on planet Earth will have doubled. By 2023, they say it will double every month. The whole data, everything that is in Google, YouTube, on your cell phone, like all the data. Guess what will happen to the 2.5 number? Can you still have a nice salary if you waste 60% of your time searching for information? Doesn't work. Employability? Down. The next number is 80%. Oh, actually, I'll help you a little bit. One click. So, 80% is the time an average knowledge worker spends in meetings and in inbox. there's not so much time left to do actual work. Some people say, sorry, I cannot prepare the meeting because I have back-to-back meetings. Nobody in this room, I know, nobody. But outside of this room, there are a lot of people who tell me they have back-to-back meetings, come home and have 80 unread emails, right? Not you, but a lot of other people. And the next day, the same thing. Fun job. It's a lot of fun, right, working like this. So here, the last one is actually the worst one. Every 3 to 5 minutes, we get interrupted. Notification, cell phone, computer, on Skype, it's with Mr. Meyer, is also online. Don't know why I should know that now, but it's telling me. No? The vibration, Instagram, WhatsApp. This is the worst thing in terms of making you successful, if you don't manage that. Because brain research says you need to work 30 to 40 minutes without one interruption on a topic to get the big picture, connect the dots, and finally say, ah, that's why I should change my strategy. But the conclusion is most knowledge workers in the Western world cannot do knowledge work anymore because they get interrupted every 3 to 5 minutes. So those who will be able to manage this have a good employability in 10 years. For all the others, I don't think so. So I put this on one page. I strongly believe if you cannot put something on one page, you have not understood it well enough. So I tried to put this in one page. These are the three overloads: data, communication, and cognitive overload. By the way, most burnouts are related to the triple overload. You go home in the evening, physically and mentally exhausted, but you haven't really achieved anything, except reply to a lot of emails. So how to fix it? How? So important. So let's look about driving a car. If you want to drive a car, you have to pass the driver's license. That's a very good idea, because think about the chaos that we would have if you drove on the left side of the street, right, left, right. If everyone could decide in here himself, because we live in the age of individualism, right, I make my own decisions, right? It's not good for streets. The whole society would crash. We could not even get food to the supermarket anymore if everyone drove on a different side. So this decision, do we drive on the left or on the right-hand side, will never win a Nobel Prize. That's so simple. But if you don't make this decision, you have a huge chaos every day. So try to find those decisions that will never win a Nobel Prize, but impact your life and your team's life every day. We will come up with a couple of them. And now, moving away from cars to team and communication, we need a communication driver's license. We need to know the basics about how to communicate. Most people I know have never learned about when should I use email, when should I use text. Right? When your house is on fire, do you send an email to the firefighter? No? Yeah? Who would? You would. Lucky you. Good. Of course not. What if it ends up in a spam filter? So next week they says, oh, I found this email, do I still need to come? No, house not there anymore. Every communication channel has pros and cons. But if you don't know them, you may choose the wrong one. Some people discuss in emails 15 times back and forth, and every time you click reply, the vocabulary changes a bit, more tense, and I told you 7 times already, right? Not in here, but outside, a lot of people do that. So we need a communication driver's license, and this is what we did. When I started at Evernote, I took everyone in the room with a big whiteboard, gave them a pen, said, guys, write on that wall what you don't like about how we work at Evernote. I left the room for 30 minutes, came back, and the whiteboard was not white anymore. It was full of stuff. Things like, do I need to read emails at 10 in the evening? Do I need to reply to emails? Do I need to reply over the weekend? Someone said, if I don't reply in the evening, do I get a lower salary increase? They would never tell you that, but this is what people are concerned with. So we created a communication charter. And this, it's too small, but you can get the slides afterwards. I put it in smaller chunks. We just talked about calendar hygiene and expectation, email hygiene and expectation. Nobody needs to read emails after 7 at Evernote because It's the wrong channel when the house is burning. Right? The house is burning, you call or send a text message. Emails can by default not be urgent, only important. And important stuff can always wait, always, right? The house on fire is urgent, but and important. So we have office hours, home office, all this. We have clarified this on one page. And now we have an employee satisfaction in the Zurich office of 97. When I started, it was 54. Just by fixing the communications chart. Very simple thing. Meetings, when do we use Slack, the chat program, and so on. If you're interested in learning more about that, we published last month a white paper about triple overload and what to do about it, because there is more than just the communication thing. It's about psychology, how to get a moment of calm to think. That has nothing to do with the tool you use. That's a mindset thing. That's a psychological game. At Evernote, we say, a fool with a tool is still a fool. Right? You need to know how to use that tool. If I give my five-year-old little boy a Ferrari, it's a Ferrari, but he doesn't know how to drive it. Useless for him. Wouldn't be useless for me, but it's useless for him. Right? Maybe it will also be useless for me. It's probably a bit an overkill. But if you want that, you can go to evernote.com/triple-overload-challenge, and you can download that paper. In a week, we will have another white paper, how to manage virtual teams. That was my PhD topic, and we created a short business paper. You can read it in about 9 to 10 minutes. How to run a virtual team, how to hire people who then work in a virtual team, how to keep them happy, and how to build trust over a big distance with different cultures and languages. This will be in about a week. That's on evernote.com/virtualteammanagement. If you're interested in that, download it and enjoy reading. Are there any questions? We have 3 minutes left. I have time for some questions and a quick demo of how I work with my big data overload. But first, I want to give some chance for questions. Everyone is sweating here. Yeah, first hand here.
What's the next
megatrend? Yeah, that's the megatrend. The incredible, massive, never seen before, unhumane overload of everything. That's it. And if you don't manage this, you're going to be flat, like the tsunami. Yeah?
And how do you recommend the right manager?
Yeah, too much inside out, not enough outside in. Right? BlackBerry did research to confirm that they should continue with their physical keyboard. They didn't allow any research who said maybe we should have a bigger screen. So you can fool yourself if you influence your own research, yeah? Sorry? No, like we had, everything ended up in one form of how we want to deal with it. Yeah. Yeah?
Was it changed in your office or in the whole
Evernote? We did it in the European office. And then other people saw, hey, how did you move the employee satisfaction from the worst of breed, 54%, to 97? And I sent him those slides. And now we have already 7 teams that use that. So every quarter we have another team applying this. Yeah. Often you cannot do top-down things in a big company. You have to do it bottom-up. Do it in your team, talk about it. People usually steal with pride from good people with good ideas. Good? The last thing I want to just show before we go, because I have 50 seconds left according to the screen here, is if you work with Evernote Business Edition, you have all the information here like PowerPoint and information and research and everything, and our tool connects your information with external information. For instance, it tells me that I should talk, the screen is gone. For whatever reason. Yeah. Doesn't come back. So I want to show, like, if you work a lot with whiteboards and flip charts, make sure you keep them in a picture. And at Evernote, we have handwriting recognition. Even if you put them in Evernote and you Google for a word that you have written by hand, it finds it. This is what I wanted to show, but something with the screen thing doesn't work. But this is something like the most creative work you usually do on whiteboard and flip charts. But most people don't keep that. They usually keep emails, but not the really important stuff. So focus on keeping the right stuff. So I hope that was a useful investment of your 25 minutes of your life. Thanks for your attention. Have a nice day.